SESI, uma iniciativa da CNI, Confederação Nacional da Indústria, apresenta.
You know, people say all the time that, you know, nowadays people change careers 3, 4, 5 times in their adult life. So it's silly to think we can prepare students to know how to do one thing. So I think what we focus on is training students to be, you know, global citizens who can live in the world and to respond to change and to intellectually deal with any challenge that's thrown to them.
I think that actually coming to Ross, what was really cool is that they're very used to having international students. So they know how to kind of adapt to each and every student and their culture and kind of help them get used to being in an American environment. I'm a boarding student and we live in houses with, you know, house parents that kind of act as your parents, and that's very different as opposed to being in a dorm.
For teachers, I think our teachers are like awesome. Yeah, they are nice, they are patient.
So shy.
Like every like teacher cares about every single student. They know, of course, they know their names or they know their personalities or what's in the background. So, and if you're failing the classes, they try anything to let you pass the class. They come ask you to come to the extra helps or they make you do the extra credit to pass the classes.
Eu vim para Ross School porque eu quero fazer faculdade pro lado da publicidade, essas coisas. Então eu queria uma escola que integrasse isso tudo, que misturasse arte, música, mídia, tudo juntos. E aí formar um currículo legal que desse uma boa saída para a universidade.
Our school have those sketchers or painting. When they teach like a history, they will show you the painting, and you will know the exact thing, but not like listen only to the books.
When I go from math to English and I walk 5 minutes through a forest, basically, to get from A to B, which is, I think that's the most rewarding part of coming to Ross School. And the food, we have amazing food. I love this school.
East Hampton is a very interesting community. It has a reputation for being a playground for people from New York City, but actually there are perhaps two communities here. There's a summer community and there's a winter community. And Ross School has been here for nearly 25 years and historically had served the children of the winter community, just local families. And as time moved along, the international population at Ross School began to grow. And our composition now is about 50 to 60% international, and the rest of the students, of course, domestic and local. This fits the mission of the school, which is not just to offer an American-centered education, but to offer a global experience where kids are not just reading and looking and thinking about what's going on elsewhere in the world in books, but they're actually in contact with people from other countries. And of course, our international students are here because they're interested in an American education, and especially the education that Ross has to offer. The school itself is located in a heavily forested area, is kept that way for a reason, and it's, again, part of the Ross aesthetic. The pathways between the buildings reflect that, too. You feel as though you're kind of walking through the woods as you're going about doing that.
One of the wonderful things about the Ross School was that Mrs. Ross was the visionary for all of these buildings that you see here. Building number one with the beautiful statue in front is the high school building, and that houses grades 9 and 10. Across the green, the Nike green we call it, is building two, or the media humanities building, and that houses grade 11. Each building reflects the curriculum. So when you walk into the 9th and 10th grade building, you'll realize that you're going to be studying about the Renaissance. When you walk into the 11th grade building, you realize you're going to be studying about the modern era by the architecture, by the artifacts. This building that we're sitting in, and I feel very fortunate to come here every day, is the senior building. This houses the core classes for the 12th graders. Building 3 is an administrative building. We have our technology offices, things like that. Building 4 is houses basically the 7th and 8th grade, and also our innovation lab.
So the school is actually physically divided into two campuses. So there's a campus that's about a 20-minute drive from here that is our lower school campus, and that covers early education, three-year-olds all the way up through grade 6. The lower school has about 100 students on it, and the upper school campus has about 420. The upper school begins in grade 7, and goes up through PG, which is postgraduate. These are students who may already have graduated from high school but are looking for an educational experience for one more year before progressing on to university.
Our classes start at 8 o'clock and they go through 4 o'clock, and there are 10 class periods during the day. Now, boarders start a little bit earlier than that because we don't live here on campus. We have beautiful boarding houses that students live in, so they'll get on a bus around 7:15, have breakfast here, then they start their classes at 8, take their core classes, which would be English, history, and science, then have a math, two languages, and two electives, in addition to a wellness class. That ends at 4 o'clock, and at that point, students can either participate in clubs, extracurricular activities, athletic teams. They have dinner here on campus. We get back on the bus at 6:15 and go back to the boarding houses. Well, again, another unique feature of Ross is the way we evaluate. We don't give the standards A, B, C, D, F. Our grading system is based on exit outcomes, so that students would get distinguished, proficient, satisfactory, or unsatisfactory. Each student gets graded on at least 3 outcomes in every class, depending on, it could be on reading, it could be on their projects, it could be on assessments. So every class is a little bit different, but students have a chance to excel in different parts of a class that in a normal classroom they might not have that opportunity to, because they're just graded on a percentage. Student, you want to make sure that they are curious intellectually. So we use inquiry-based learning here, kind of a Socratic method where students are being asked questions to learn deeper. But the most important thing that we can teach students are also our life skills and ways to learn how to learn, to feel confident and self-confident. And with that self-confidence, any student anywhere can go out in the world and be successful. Students can articulate their thoughts, they understand the curriculum, and they can integrate their thoughts in many different disciplines, which is very unique, as opposed to just being a math person or a science person. At Ross, students really become experts in all fields. And it's a result of our curriculum, it's a result of our teachers, it's a result of the confidence that students learn by working with caring teachers all the time.
The Spiral Curriculum at Ross is an approach to teaching students everything that they learn in a historical context. So students start in the early grades in human prehistory, and as they go through the grade levels, they're marching through time in all their subjects together. So in the eighth grade, they're studying the Middle Ages, and in the ninth grade, the Renaissance, and in the 10th grade, the Enlightenment. So that when they're learning physics in grade 9, they're not just learning physics out of the textbook, they're learning physics from Galileo and Newton and Copernicus and the people who were doing science in the time period that they're studying in their English class, and they're studying in their art class, and they're studying in their cultural history class. So the idea is that by teaching all of the subjects in a sort of chronology, you're teaching students that these different realms of human knowledge are not separate from one another, that they emerged at a particular place in time that we're all at one point connected to one another. And it's also telling a story. There's a narrative to the curriculum that a student who's been through grades 11 and 10 and 9 and 8 can move back and forth chronologically in that curriculum and make connections between what they learned in the earlier grades and what they learned in the later grades, both vertically through the time periods and then horizontally within the grade with everything they're learning in their different subjects.
The history curriculum sort of sets the year-long path for the entire core area classes and what we call the integrated arts classes. And the integrated arts are performing arts, media studies, and visual arts. And that integrated art integrates with the other three core classes, and all of them are organized around this historical narrative. And then other disciplines look at this and figure out, they all have their own unique needs. Like, I'm an English teacher, so there are things I need to do for my English class. I can't only be serving the history narrative. So they kind of negotiate how they can find connections. People who work at the school have to be collaborators. If you're not a collaborator, you don't belong in this school.
Almost
almost got it. That's all right. That's close.
跟我说这是谁？这是谁？
They have to connect at the bottom.
这里看我们看看。谁是这？谁是这？不错，不错，谢谢。请坐，请坐。这边。
We're going to put an adjective in here. Okay, so the pattern is always Thai. The adjective and then a le. What if it's too hot? 太热了。太热了。It's too cold.
It starts in earlier. We start in the lower school here. So in the lower school, we're working on Mandarin as early as, you know, third, fourth grade. And all the way up through the time they graduate. Typical class comes in and right away they start speaking Mandarin. That is to say that they have to sort of, much of their day is English, 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 so they have 45 minutes to only speak Mandarin. And so I make sure that that happens. So from the get-go, I warm their brains up, I ask them a little bit about themselves, have them start speaking, what's the day like, and then slowly when their brain is warmed up, we roll into a little bit of conversation, some information, and knowledge about what they're missing. Maybe basically a little bit of review. What have we gone over culturally? What have we gone over historically? And how do you say that all in Mandarin? My focus is for them to continue holding on to the vocabulary and grammar that I've taught them and the facts and history that I've taught them. And it's important that they don't lose that. So I have to make sure that they speak Mandarin.
对的，太好了。明天是星期几？明天是星期四。明天星期四，非常好。明天今天二十啊，今天是十六号，对不对？明天是星期四，对吗？对对，好，好吧。
How does Mandarin apply to the spiral curriculum? Mandarin applies because you have to look at things often from an Eastern standpoint. Oftentimes in American education especially, we are so focused on the Western story, the story of Western civilization, European civilization and history, and oftentimes China and the East gets sort of forgotten about. So we not only take language, but you take culture as well, and you blend them together at different grade levels. Therefore, someone in the ninth grade is going to get information about the Ming Dynasty, what happened in the Ming Dynasty, the culture of the Ming Dynasty, the society of the Ming Dynasty, what people were like in the Ming Dynasty. At the same time, you're learning language and how it applies to certain aspects of your life here. They can have a basic conversation. They can leave having a full knowledge of cultural and history of the country of China, as well as conduct at the very basic level a conversation, introduce themselves, and know a little bit about people around them in Mandarin.
好，意思来说，爬山。爬山。看太阳。看太阳。什么意思？Sunrise。看。See the sunrise。See the sunrise。太好了，太好了，太好了。
The idea behind that was initiated by our founder, sort of because of the growing prevalence of Mandarin-speaking people in the world of economics and the business world. It's becoming more and more widespread, an asset to use in the future. But other than that, it's just a really fun language to learn. I actually like it a lot, and I really enjoy studying it, and I plan to keep studying it in college. Both of my parents work at Ross. My mother works in publishing, and my dad is David Morgan. He's director of the Innovation Lab. He worked at Ross back when it first started out, sort of pioneering the science curriculum. So he taught several of the grades. And then we were away for a while, and he came back 4 years ago to start up this Innovation Lab, which is a science and math academy for students who are particularly interested in STEM fields.
The idea for the Innovation Lab came in the summer of 2012, and they invited me to meet with them about their ideas for the program, and at that time they invited me to be the director. So I was the founding director of the program. The idea for the program is a place for students who are really interested in science and math and technology and who are really passionate about these areas to do independent work and to create something that they're passionate about and that goes outside of what you can do in a regular classroom. So we do have specialized academic courses for the program. There are courses in robotics, there are courses in 3D printing, there are courses in marine biology and ecology, there are courses in computer programming and all sorts of things like that. And the Innovation Lab students do take those courses. But there's also every day of the week, their school day is extended by a whole hour longer than all the rest of the students. And they have open lab time where they can work on independent projects, where they're building things or programming things or creating things that are their own idea. So that extra hour every single day is something that you can't really have in a classroom environment. So we try to give the students extra resources, extra time, extra support to create things that you can't really do in a typical science classroom. We have the high school program is the 5-day-a-week program, so that's grades 9 through 12. For younger students, we have a program called Junior Innovation Lab, which actually goes all the way down to grade 5, so grade 5 through 8, and that's a 2-day-a-week after-school enrichment experience where students get to kind of get a flavor of some of these tools and some of the hands-on stuff. So as soon as students join the program in the ninth grade, I try to give them a project right away so they can start to develop these skills of not just science and technology and math skills, but project management and dealing with obstacles and all the things that you need to do to tackle a project that's as extended as some of these projects are. The classes are mandatory in that, you know, students at Ross have a huge variety of classes they can take. They can take classes in dance and yoga and philosophy and art. The Innovation Lab students' choices are constrained a little bit. The projects, while it's mandatory that they do a project, what they actually do is entirely up to them. We have a long list of project ideas that they can look at to get ideas for things. But I try to have them pick something kind of small and doable that they can finish in a trimester, you know, let's say finish by Christmas or so, to get an idea of where students' strengths and weaknesses are. You know, what we're trying to do is by giving them smaller experiences early on to sort of build on that, so by the time they're seniors, they can do these things with very little guidance from us, and I basically have to give them the tools and stand back and let them work.
Well, in 10th grade at Ross, in the innovation lab, I took the skeleton that we have here, and it had some missing bones, so I took the bones that were there and replicated them on the printer and printed them out to replace the bones that were missing. Well, once I had finished the skeleton, I wanted to make a more complete study guide, I guess, for students who are trying to learn about the human body. So I thought if I had the skeleton, then I should create the organs that go inside of it. I'm holding the 3D printed heart that I printed myself based off of MRI files that I found online.
As far as interest in science and technology for the Innovation Lab, really the program tends to draw the students who are already really interested in science, really interested in math, really interested in technologies. Particularly the students who come here for this program, they already have that passion, and that's the kind of student we're looking for. One of the things we do though, is we make all of our Innovation Lab electives open to any student at Ross School. So we have students who might take a 3D printing class just because they saw 3D printers on the news and thought it was something cool, who don't think of themselves as science students, who don't think of themselves as technology students. And that pulls more students into the program. If there's something that a student wants to do that we don't have, I try my best to get them those resources. You know, they have to make a budget and they have to make the case for why they need what they need. And that's part of the innovation process, is understanding that resources are unlimited, that if they want to do something, they have to know what that project will take. And so those are valuable skills as well. The students with one another, it's a small group. There's usually between 12 and 16 students. So it's a small collegial group where everyone knows everybody. Everybody can ask someone for help. Everybody knows kind of who's good at programming and who's good at 3D printing and who knows how to work a particular piece of equipment. So they can all collaborate on stuff as needed.
Let's eliminate.
At Ross, we have to do senior projects. So I've been in Innovation Lab. I've always been interested in biology and the anatomy of the body. Before, when they were asking us about senior projects and what our ideas were, I basically said, well, I wanted to do like a robotic hand because I thought it was something cool and new, and I didn't really have an like idea of what I was gonna do, but I thought of this. And then over the summer, I volunteered at a nursing home, and at that nursing home, I volunteered in the physical therapy unit, where I got to work with amputees and different patients that had their loss in a limb or had strokes, so they couldn't walk anymore and had to have help to be able to do all the regular activities again. So then I got more interested in building a robotic arm.
Inovar na educação é você tentar pensar em alguma forma onde você consiga melhorar o resultado da aprendizagem dos educandos, né? Então, a cultura maker, né, é uma forma de você trabalhar onde você faz muita coisa com as próprias mãos, né? E isso tem um fascínio inicial, né? Quando a pessoa começa a criar coisas e vê o resultado da criação dela, tem um prazer imediato naquilo lá. E um engajamento. Então, isso já faz uma das grandes coisas, que é trazer algum significado para a aprendizagem. Então, a pessoa já entra dentro desse ambiente, né, de construir com uma intenção muito maior do que se fica só no espectro teórico. Muita coisa no espaço maker é feito em grupo. Então, você aprende a trabalhar em grupo, aprende a cooperar. Você tem problemas ali que acontecem, que não tem respostas e nem muitas vezes o professor também não tem. Então, você começa a desenvolver o pensamento crítico, você começa a pensar naquilo e falar, poxa, como é que eu vou sair daqui? Como é que eu vou construir isso daqui? Isso são exercícios que você faz internamente, que você vai criando caminhos internos de criatividade. Então, tem uma série de habilidades não cognitivas, né, que a gente chama, que você se desenvolve trabalhando num ambiente assim. Está se falando muito, né, na cultura maker e esses espaços onde tem essas máquinas digitais, né, impressora 3D, cortadora laser, roteadora. Na realidade, essas máquinas, elas são boas na medida em que o que você quer fazer necessita de um equipamento como esse. Mas a cultura maker, de você fazer as coisas, você pode fazer com tecnologias bem mais analógicas, vamos dizer assim, né? Com martelo, alicate, a própria mão, os materiais podem ser bem simples, né? As construções podem ser de outra forma, não precisa ser nada muito tecnológico. A tecnologia, ela é boa na medida em que ela é útil.
Every August, for 3 weeks, the faculty come together for professional development. And what they do is run us through a program of training and in pedagogy and sometimes in content for those 3 weeks. We might have new teachers. A lot of times we have veteran teachers. So the first week is sort of regrouping, identifying what we need to accomplish for the 3 weeks. The second week is introduction to new ideas or new research. And then the third week, a lot of times, is sort of, you know, finishing up some of the projects that we had started first week and continued to the extent that was possible in the second week, and also preparing for the students who are imminently arriving by then. But we spend a lot of time working in our department, at the department level, like the history department working together, or the teams working together to design or refine curriculum that was delivered the previous year, or maybe some new idea that someone has. This is a really good time for that because we have, you know, chunks of time, like maybe 3 hours, where we can sit and sort of brainstorm and move away and then brainstorm some more.
I mean, right now you have it here.
Oh, I
think. Leave this and maybe play with the
what about
background?
This part?
I don't know.
Again, one of the things about Ross is that everything is individualized for each student. So students get to pursue what they're passionate about, and that builds self-confidence. And with that self-confidence, students can advocate for themselves. They can speak very clearly. And again, one of those beautiful things about Ross is that students can speak with adults. You can have fifth graders talking to adults in a very mature manner because they've learned how to articulate their thoughts in class. The students are graded in a very different way. We don't have a traditional A, B, C, D, F program. Students are graded in narratives and by what's called distinguished, proficient, satisfactory, and unsatisfactory. And they're graded on outcomes. And part of the outcomes could be speaking, listening, which is very important in students being able to, again, articulate their thoughts.
No, I figured out that, no, it's not done yet, so it's not.
That's okay, it doesn't have to be done yet.
I figured out what I'm gonna do at the end. Well,
what did you like about it?
Can I ask what I didn't like about it?
Yes.
It doesn't really have conflict yet, but then I figured out how I'm gonna do it.
Which is?
So basically, like she said, she has a perfect PSAT score, and it's proven that people that have a higher IQ than 140 take drugs. And then since she's like uptight all the time because she has to take care of her her brothers and sisters, like they were her own children, and among that, like on top of that, she has school and she has to like do everything around her house. She like ends up taking drugs and then she like misses her SAT or something, and then.
So how did she get the drugs? From Sharquesia.
from Jake.
Who gets them from Sharquesia. No, wait.
From Jake.
Jake deals them to Sharquesia.
And then Jake also deals them to her.
Yeah.
Okay, before we forget what that one's like, could we go to number 19?
Theatre is not mandatory at Ross. The extracurricular productions that we do are entirely voluntary, but there is a mandatory element in that we integrate theatre into the classroom. So I work closely with the English and Cultural History departments, and over the years I've established what I think is a very interesting curriculum, obviously with the help of others. Well, I'm always at pains to tell them that I'm not expecting you to be a great actor, but I do expect you to start to use your voice, learn to use your voice. And one of the things I say is that when you walk into an interview, whatever it might be, the first thing they notice is how you look. The second thing they notice is what comes out of your mouth and how you present it. So I'm very, very conscious of trying to get these kids to think about framing their sentences, how they want to clarify an idea and then really very quickly formulate the words that they want to use. Whether they then go on to develop a passion for acting, I have no control over, but it's interesting how many have. And off they go and study theatre at college, so it's great. But they don't have to. Guys, in all seriousness, what would be good would be for you to get in touch get in touch with your diaphragm. Because if you're going, ha, ha, or if you're doing it from up here, it doesn't work. But if just practice, ha, 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 right? But seriously, but listen. You can laugh, but the fact is, if you'd get in touch with your diaphragm, your breathing mechanism and your whole vocal projection mechanism is functioning correctly. And it's much less tiring than creating all this tension up here and running out of breath. It really does make a difference, trust me. And I know you're smirking at me and going, what's that silly old fart talking about? But after 40 odd years, I do know a little bit. Anyway. Now get on with it, for God's sake.
The Center for Well-Being, which is the closest thing we have to a student center. The Center for Well-Being houses what's called the Great Hall, gymnasium to other people, but it's called the Great Hall because, again, of its architecture. Absolutely beautiful. In the basement, it has a movement room called Gandhi Hall, where students get to dance, practice movement. We have a meditation room, a weight room, and locker rooms. And then on top of that, we have a little koi pond, actually, inside.
All of our Ross students have to take a Eastern Wellness class before they graduate. It's a graduation requirement. Through wellness, the way that I try and organize and lead the curriculum is that we're trying to get the students to be self-sufficient and to be agents, strong, focused agents that are self-sustainable and that also value the wellness of others. As they approach young adulthood, I think students encounter difficult emotions that can give them a lot of confusion. So wellness encompasses how to be literate about your own growth and being able to regulate ways of relating to the world so that students are not engaged in behavior or habits that might be destructive to their health.
So the Ross Cafe has been acknowledged by two different magazines. One said we were the best cafe of all schools in the country. They had us listed as fourth. Either way, we're in the top five. And it's because we have these healthy, nutritious meals that the cafe prepares every single day. Here at Ross, we talk about the whole child. So you're not going to see any vending machines on campus, no snack machines on campus. You'll see baskets of fruit outside the classrooms. That's reflected by Liz Dobbs, who runs our cafe.
So we offer prepared food and raw food for our students from a variety of cuisines. It's important that they have the energy to learn. Courtney Ross was a very early pioneer in this concept. Over almost 20 years ago, she decided that her students needed good food, nutritious food, organic food, wholesome food, in order to provide energy for them to learn well. She also connected mind and body very early on.
I'm in the Tennis Academy, which is a separate program, which is part of the school, and it's 5 days a week. I came to Ross because of the Tennis Academy, because it was really hard for me to travel in the city to different tennis clinics because there was always so much traffic. Also, I was able to balance my time with homework and tennis easier. At first, when you're a new student, sometimes it's a little bit tough to fit in or get involved, but I think that's with anywhere when you're changing. But after a little bit, I felt really welcomed, surprisingly. The thing about Ross is really disciplined. If you're not catching up with your work or if you're falling behind, they're not gonna let you play tennis. So if you really like tennis and you're in the Tennis Academy, then you really have to focus on your schoolwork. For me, schoolwork is definitely my priority, and then it's tennis when I'm ever falling behind. Since I'm pretty self-sufficient with my tennis and my schoolwork, I will take tennis off for that day to catch up on my schoolwork, because we do have less time to do work than most of the kids since we get home later. But if you are not really holding up on your own, then the coaches are gonna make you work on your schoolwork instead of playing tennis, which is good. It's good to be disciplined like that.
Ross really satisfied what Gabe was looking for and what we were looking for in Gabe, which was a great tennis program on site with wonderful instructors, and what most great tennis programs in this country and elsewhere don't have is a great educational program. Well, there is a parent-teacher day at the beginning of each school year in October. So I come and I spend 15 minutes or so with each of the teachers early on in the year. I get to see them, I get to hear about how they're approaching the course. They'll have their initial observations of Gabe, who they've had in the class for 6 weeks at that point, and they have a pretty good sense of him at that point. And then in terms of feedback after that moment, they will post by email on a platform grades as they are generated. But I get a pretty good feel in real time how Gabe is doing in each of the classes. And then at the end of each of the trimesters, there is a more formal report that I get that also includes some narrative commentary about Gabe and his progress and areas of improvement, areas of challenge, and that helps me understand where he is and what support he might need. How it works for the Tennis Academy students is they take all of their core courses in the mornings, and rather than go on to the electives in the afternoon, as the non-Tennis Academy students do, Gabe at that point comes to the tennis center for his training, and then at 8:30 or so, he gets back to his boarding house in time to begin homework. So it's a long, long day. In terms of Gabe being just 2.5 hours away, on the one hand, it is different not having your son at home for high school, which we had always expected him to be, but we get to see Gabe a fair amount, and of course today with Skype and FaceTime, there aren't too many days that go by when we don't get a look at Gabe's face. So I really don't feel, as I had feared, a disconnect with Gabe, but at the same time, he is, although only 2.5 hours away, it's a world away in many respects, because he's living with Brazilians and Germans, and he just is having such a rich cultural experience, something that he frankly wasn't getting in Brooklyn at his school there. So that's been a real upside in addition to the tennis.
Eu moro nos Estados Unidos, esse é meu sexto ano. Na Ross eu tenho duas funções. Eu trabalho como um associate no Office de Admissions. A minha outra função técnico, né, de tênis, eu sou um tennis pro, que eles chamam. Ajudo eles no que for do meu alcance, tanto dentro da quadra como fora da quadra, fazendo o house parent, que é o meu third duty, né, a minha terceira responsabilidade. Como house parent, a minha função é basicamente ser pai dos alunos, né? O que é meio estranho, porque eu tenho 24 anos de idade, a minha diferença de idade para eles não é tão grande. Mas o meu role, a minha função principal é o que eu tenho que supervisionar, sabe? Ver se os quartos deles estão limpos, se eles estão fazendo as obrigações dele na casa, limpando as áreas comuns, deixando os quartos prontos e tudo isso. A minha relação com os alunos, eu tento fazer ela o mais agradável possível para eles, entendeu? Porque o schedule que eles têm é um schedule muito intenso. imenso, sabe? Eles saem de casa às 7:30 da manhã e 3 vezes por semana eles vão voltar para casa às 9 da noite. Então eles já estão cheios de regras na escola, como se comportar, o que usar, uniforme. Então quando eles vêm para casa, eu tenho que manter a minha função de house parent, mas igual eu falei, eu tento deixar eles um pouco mais liberal, entendeu?
Sustainability is one of the threads throughout our curriculum, so we talk about it with kindergarten students all the way up through grade 12. The idea of sustainability is not just about the environment and about how man has damaged the environment and how can we sustain it for the future, but it also talks about cultural sustainability. So many of our students are learning about different cultures, and these past 3 weeks, students traveled around the world in what's called our Field Academy and went to different indigenous cultures. So for instance, students went to New Zealand and studied with the Maori tribes there and went to their school and talked about the way that they can sustain their culture.
Okay, so yeah, Victoria, a 5-minute video would be fantastic. The more you can include culturally, the better. I know there's a lot of good scenery, a lot of fun stuff that we were doing, but if you have stuff like Haka, if you have stuff like the stuff in the Marae, that would be fantastic.
So about 4 or 5 days ago, we got back from a trip to New Zealand, where for 2 weeks we were studying Maori culture and cultural sustainability in that area. So what we're doing right now is in about a week or week and a half, we're going to be presenting in front of the whole school what we did and what we learned. So right now we're just talking about how we're going to do that and how best we can convey the things we learned. And in sort of in its own right, that's a method of cultural sustainability, since we're spreading awareness and teaching some other people about the sorts of things we're doing. So we're putting together a video about all the places we went, all the people we stayed with. I've been on Field Academy before. I'm sort of offering some guidance as an older student.
At this point, Victoria is going to be making a 5-6 minute video or so from the footage that she has and from the footage that Jess has compiled as well. We are going to need you. Thank you so much for paying attention, Danny. We are going to need you guys to record a voiceover for that at some point. We can have, I don't know, we could draft a brief summary of the cultural preservation portion of the trip, and then we can adapt it to the video.
I can write voiceovers if you want me to.
Okay, let's have a group, let's have a team.
Yeah.
Let's have a team.
Hey, who wants to be on my voiceover writing team?
Fantastic. We need two more individuals to join Katie and Leaf on working on the voiceover. Lily, fantastic. One more?
I was thinking about one.
No, not you, for sure.
Because you have the 3D printing. So we need one more whose name is not Natalia, whose name is not Raphael, and India, okay.
Okay, guys, I'll send you a list of topics tonight, and then if you could just draft up something on one or two of them, I can assign them to by person if you want. And then once we see the video, we can adapt them into more specific voiceovers. Cool? Okay.
Fantastic.
Field Academy is the most amazing opportunity I've had, and there's nothing like it I could have done without Ross. And the things I've learned there and studying there with people who grew up just so vastly differently from the way I did, it really broadens my experience. And I think that's what education should be about. I think education should be about broadening your experience and broadening your knowledge and seeing as much as you can, so that when you confront problems, you confront it with all this background knowledge and all this diversity in order to come to more complex conclusions.
Again, something that we're developing here is a very strong advisory program, where every day students get to meet with their advisor. There are usually groups of 6 to 8 students for every advisor. Students sometimes have an opportunity to choose who the advisor is. It's an adult advocate here. They can talk to them about issues they're having, about academics. We also do a little tutoring during that period of time. But the advisor is generally the person, the first person that a student can go to here. And I can tell you that I'm in touch with kids that were my advisees from 35 years ago.
So in advisory, especially with my seniors at the end of the year, I'd like to ask them two very important questions. First question being, what do you think of as the most pivotal point of your Ross career? And you've been here since freshman year, so yeah. What do you think?
I think definitely senior project, because sort of like you go through, especially if you're here from all the years and you're watching the presentations, like you go through just like waiting for that and sort of thinking about that. And I think it's really like the culmination. And I think being up on stage and like it just being my time, like it's my class and I know more about this than anyone else in the room, is just, first of all, so empowering, but also like you're really, it's like a coming of age, I think, for the Ross School. It's like now you're an adult, now you're a senior, now you're through.
Katie. What did your shirt say?
I want to first commend you, Katie, on your courage and hard work, your diligence, and especially your crusade for women everywhere. You truly are an inspiration. Ladies and gentlemen, Katie Morgan.
I want to start by telling you why I decided to put this up behind me. In all honesty, it makes me really uneasy.
And the second question being, how has Ross helped you kind of formulate your idea of who you want to be in the future or what you want to do in the future?
I think I've been given enough, like, the freedom to go off and explore things that, like, that's something that I never want to lose. Like, I always want to have the chance to be taking classes that aren't necessarily part of what my career is going to be, but like to always have that openness of study, like where and someone's going to help me learn whatever I want to learn. And then I think the communities like taught me how to interact professionally, like since everything's sort of on you to get things done and to get meetings set up and to communicate, it sort of taught me how to be part of a professional community, because I feel like I'm like on par with the teachers, especially as a senior, but I've always felt on par with the teachers. Like we're collaborating rather than one's above me and I'm below. Like I feel like we're collaborators in the same education experience. So I've sort of like learned to collaborate.
I love it. And the last question is, and I don't ask this to all of my seniors, are you sure you have to leave me? Because I'm going to miss you.
Oh, goodness. Yeah.
Oh, my goodness. You better.
I will.
Well, if you look at our mission statement here at Ross, we say that we want to create global citizens for a global community. So the idea of, or I would say the major objective, is for students to learn about global affairs, global history, to appreciate all cultures, and to develop creative thinkers, students that can go out into the world and really make a difference in the way they think. And, you know, many college students have come back to us, you know, Ross graduates, and tell us how they see the curriculum and the world differently than their fellow students even in college. And that's very important for us because, again, what's happened to American education, it's happening to a lot of places around the world. We've become a very test-based society. And Ross is not about that. It's about outcome-based. Right. We don't use the word tolerate. We want people to understand everyone, their cultures, and be able to appreciate the gifts that they have.
Uma parceria SESI, uma iniciativa da CNI, Confederação Nacional da Indústria.